Welcome to this week's CENTCOM or Central Command. I'm Jeff Lovett. Glad to be with you this week. If it's your first time on the clicking on the broadcast, as you know, in 1983, the Lord really impressed on Bob's heart, what would it be like to see cities and nations that would love Jesus well? And so this is a time really where we can feed and fuel your heart in this hope message, which really can overflow into seeing businesses, cities, families love him well. And so we really believe these are real practical tools to help you do that on a daily basis in all these different areas of life. And so today we're talking about these benevolent kings and queens coming forth, and that's you, and really how we raise you up, and you're coming forth through the door of hope and appreciation and love. And so we're going to talk a little bit about that. And so again, we'll have Eddie Boasso, Bob Fraser, and Bob Hartley really drill into that. And I just love some of the things that Bob's talking about. It's really just this Jesus, man of hope, being magnified. So let me give you a couple resources. I always talk about the Adoration Prayer Book. It's one of the most practical tools for you. The 52 Weeks of Hope is such a great practical tool, how we can mentor you week in and week out, and then also you can give back to the ministry at the same time. So you can see details about that on the website. So be blessed by this week's broadcast, and I'll come back at the end and recap.
Hello and welcome again to this week's CENTCOM with Bob and Eddie Boasso. So Eddie, tell us about this testimony of this lady, and then why don't you open us with some adoration?
Yeah, I'd love to. We were in Roseville, and during the meeting, the Lord just so blessed us with his presence and his power was there, and one of the young gals that was singing, she had an encounter she had never had before, and the Holy Spirit just overcame her. But in that time where the Lord was on her, Jesus visited her. She never had this type of experience before where she saw him. And she came up to me after the meeting, and she said, "My life's forever changed. I never had this happen to me before," where the Lord himself just appeared to her in a measure that stunned her and shocked her and just showed how significant and special she was. And so it's just a wonderful testimony, just one of many, of how when the presence of God is in our midst, anything can happen, even to the degree that he appears and visits his children. So Lord, we just come before you and thank you how you visit us. How you visit us in very subtle ways, and how you visit us in those dramatic ways. We thank you, great God. How you took the time to visit that young girl, that you changed her view of you, that you gave her significance, because you're the great God of love that gives meaning and value and purpose to human beings. And you took this one and you touched her life. We thank you, God. Oh, Lord, we love you. We adore you. We say that you're good. You're that Psalm 25 God who is good. It's who you are. It's what you do. And we just bring you into the center by declaring who you are, God, that your presence would come and drown out all the other voices.
Yes.
As we stare into your face, as we draw near to you, that we would soar and come above the clouds and be defined by you. That Romans 15:13, God of hope, where you come and infuse hope and strength in our hearts. where you give us a higher gaze, a higher vision. You lift us up out of our day's challenges and problems, where we get to go face to face with you and stare into joy, stare into gladness, stare into hope, stare into faith. So we say, Lord, have your way today. Even on those viewing, would you come and just brighten up the room, change the atmosphere. Come and fill this place with your presence. We love you. We thank you. We praise you for who you are. You're that Psalm 4 God that comes and puts gladness right into our heart. You desire to put gladness into our heart because it's who you are. It's what you do. You love us. You love human beings. You come and make all things new. We're new creations in you. Oh God, we thank you as the great Redeemer. You changed our life.
Yes,
you changed God. Us, God. You redeemed us. You brought us close. You're not the distant God. You're near. Like David said, where can I go from your presence? You're all around us, Lord. You're even here, even now. And we thank you for being the near God. The God who sees, the God who cares. That 1 Peter 5 reality where we cast our cares upon you. You desire this because you care for us. You care for us. You care for the details. You're the God of the details.
Yes.
Everything is significant to you because we're significant to you. You take our ashes and you make them beautiful because you're the beautiful God. And we thank you, God. And we just bless your name and we love you in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord God.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Eddie.
Excellent, Eddie.
Well, last week we shared about this Hope Reformation and the nets of 1984 being opened up again, which speaks of the harvest. We talked about some of the testimonies, amazing testimonies of healing and power that God is bringing, and not just physical, but into hearts in healing and hope, but the physical too. And
callings.
And callings being released. And you had this encounter as you were in Reading, visiting, you know, for the graduation, about the benevolent kings and queens are being released. And hey, I know you felt this was real significant. And so why don't you just read this encounter?
Excellent. Very good. Yeah, I want to read it. That I was in Reading, and the Lord gave a prophetic call. And he said, there will be the return of the hopeful hope reformers who are benevolent kings and queens. And are called to build joyful community celebration centers. And then he took me to see cities as joyful community celebration centers and gave me distinctives of different cities, geographical regions, and how they would reflect God. And he showed me how in these cities that even in the marketplace with the church, the emphasis in the past had been on the cause, where you put on the Ephesians 6 armor and run out and fight. And he said, now it had been moving to the calling, where people think a lot about the redemptive gifts and the glory in them and taking the glory in them into the seven mountains of influence. Well, he spoke to me in this encounter. He said, these joyful community celebration centers will have those ingredients, those building blocks. But I have the third as the strongest one, and it's Christ. There's a cause where you get out there and you fight and win a war. Then there's, like David did, then there's the calling where you're unlocking the beauty of who you are in God and you're being everything you were meant to be. And that's beautiful to see. But this third reality in this counter that he showed me was the Christ would be unfolded in these geographical regions and cities. It was a Moses reality.
This is the face-to-face. It's the personal, the person of Jesus. And it's not just a cause or a calling, but it's him personally being opened up, being loved.
Yes. It's him being opened up and being loved. And it's him not walking lonely in the political, educational.
Being included in our lives, in our day-to-day lives.
Yeah. And you can even walk out a calling in him, but be unaware. You can enjoy the presence of him unto yourself. Versus, worthy is the Lamb to receive all glory and honor and praise. Worthy that my heart aches for him to be loved and recognized.
In a city. In a geographic region, in an organization or business that's devoid of him.
Yeah.
So it's bringing him, you know, not just in your own personal life, but into areas.
Yes. It's the Exodus 33. It's the Moses said, I can't go unless your presence goes, unless I know that. I think there was two things that Moses was saying. Was one, I need your presence or I won't succeed. But also, I can't go if I can't live this life in a way that your presence is honored and valued, and I'm seeing you every day being refreshed by our love. You know, the last question of every day going, how was your heart blessed and refreshed? How did I see you? How did I give you worthy love? How did I experience you and bring you forth in an area? So I had this encounter. I was walking through the streets in Redding, California, so it was actually an open vision. It was about 2 a.m. one night in April. This has been a little while ago. And he spoke that to me. He said, I suddenly saw orange all around me. And I'd never seen the color orange released from heaven like that. And I just knew it meant hope. And so now people have said to me orange means authority or it means, you know, biblically. But they've said it means hope as well. And so I saw a huge set of wooden doors. This is the encounter. And the Lord kept repeating to me over and over, it's time for the return of these benevolent, hopeful kings and queens who will have Christ at the center and bring Christ forth in the church and all the arenas of life. And he said, but they couldn't come through the doors, the kings, without love, hope, and appreciation. And he spoke to me, and this has been confirmed, about 7 visits from the Lord. So we don't bring it to a CENTCOM until we bake the cake. And I just want to back up, and he spoke to me in this prophetic encounter, just the importance of this must hear, kings must hear from the voice of the Lord every day. You know, just the importance of his voice. And when kings succeeded, it was the kings that inquired of the Lord. When kings did not succeed, it was the kings that did it on their own. And so in this encounter, he talked about these kings that would come through the door of love, appreciation, and hope. And then he started to speak about how would they advance
and so other people appreciating them, or is it just being appreciated by God? And
both. Excellent question. Both. It was really both. They had to be. They must have God and people believe in that. You know, and really the picture of 2 Samuel 5, which we won't get into now, but David's going to go against an enemy bigger than him. And he needs to inquire of God and God to appreciate him and say, you're able. But he also needed support from marvelous comrades. Three cups of tea, this picture was in the East, like in Afghanistan. If they give you one cup of tea, it means you're an acquaintance. If they give you a second cup of tea, it means you're a marvelous comrade. If they give you a third cup of tea, it means they'll die for you. So I saw the third cup of tea, people coming forth in this encounter with the Lord. The kings have been hidden behind these great wooden doors. So I tell it to Benny Johnson, because I happen to be in Reading, and she said, it's her favorite movie, which I haven't gotten a chance to really see the movies, or if I've watched them, I've been doing paperwork or not paying attention, but she talked about a movie where Argon, if I'm saying it right, was a king in the movie, and he wouldn't come through the door. He wouldn't take his place.
But Lord of the Rings, Lord the Return of the King, Aragorn.
Aragorn. So. So, but a woman, I guess, that's helpful. A woman really spoke to him, belief and confidence and appreciation. And I'll find, I go from setting to setting, and it says a prophet isn't honored in his own home, you know. And so I'll go to setting, and there'll be different settings where there's love and appreciation and hope, not the praise of man. And the prophetic will be so unlocked, and the authority will be so unlocked in my life.
Through appreciation, through simple just appreciation.
Yeah, it's what, you know, Jesus counted it as so important. He did it through his angels to Mary, most beautiful amongst women. He did it to Gideon, valiant man. He did it to Daniel, what do you call Daniel? Highly esteemed. And so I believe we've extracted appreciation, and that was part of the visitation, was just of the Lord that would help us in all the realms, like in the marketplace, is a restoring of appreciation and bringing that back.
So let me summarize. So these benevolent kings and queens coming forth means, one, power and wealth, but it also means more than a power in the presence.
Yes.
To go and establish the person of Jesus in places. So, and I was just getting a picture as you're saying this of, the Lord calling me perhaps to a large, secular Jewish bank in New York City or something. And I'm saying, Lord, I'm only going to go not only if I can personally experience your presence, but if I have the privilege of bringing your presence to that place, yeah. If I can see it transformed. And then the Lord giving me the tools to do that in adoration, daily adoration, and in marvelous camaraderie. So he's raising up, he's really speaking about organizations, geographic areas that he wants to go and establish.
Excellent.
Kings. Excellent. Who are carrying his presence and maybe
Excellent.
A financial anointing too.
Excellent.
And who will walk through that door and be able to open these doors through entering this place of daily communion with God, daily feeding on the bread of life,
yes.
Jesus Christ personally,
yes.
And marvelous camaraderie.
Yes. Perfect. I just really value the part you're saying, a marvelous camaraderie, because it is the word of the Lord to you to go to banks. But if you don't have marvelous comrades that are behind you that are being able to stand with you, being able to call out the best in you, being able to release the angels with you. So I won't go unless I have two things. I really know his presence is going to go, and I really have the support of marvelous comrades. I'm just not going to go.
Absolutely.
I went alone on this last trip, and even though I went to a place where they really love me, they're for me, I didn't have those that were in sync moment by moment in the way that I needed it, where I could just stop and guide the meeting and say, yeah. We need a door now.
Yeah.
They're just not the Joel 2,
yeah.
Arm in arm, shoulder to shoulder buddies,
yeah.
That know how to not break right.
We've talked
and
about
that
this.
Is so significant.
We've talked about this, for years, and the Lord showed you that he would give us the highest heights, give his people Everest. I mean, the highest heights of the mountains of the earth and the mountains of his presence. Mm-hmm. But we had to go together. We had to be roped together,
yep.
And I would not send my son to Everest unless he was roped together,
yeah.
And God is not sending his sons and daughters to Everest unless we're roped together. And we had to do it together. And, the glory and the gory of fighting through human relationships and, but to establish that marvelous camaraderie is
and
the
I think
key.
That led to the real, it was all weighty, but then the second part of this visitation was it took me from the reality of the invitation of kings and queens that could go in and really make a difference. Like right now this summer, we need kings and queens that can make a difference. The market going down 1,000 points and maybe tumbling the 3,200 is not the highest in the desire of the Lord. And I'll tell that next SENCOM why. It's not the highest. People say shake. Let everything be shaken that should be shaken. I agree. That's a scripture. But there's financial locomotives that are not to be shaken,
right.
That are countries, that are businesses that will do good and take the gospel and finance those
Amen.
In the house of prayer and other places that are to be able to move forward. So what I saw in the next part of the visitation was I saw the kings were they were to decree over one another, and they were to help build each other up. But right now, the kings were critiquing one another.
Ooh.
And there was this antithesis demon that had come in, where they were watching each other go out into the harvest, and they were like the ones who would run up to Jesus. I mean, this was a full-out 3D vision from the Lord, technicolor vision from the Lord. I do not have those. And I'm seeing different ones that I know and don't know run out and really get a real harvest from the Lord. But I'm standing by the Lord, and the others are running up and saying, they're casting out demons in your name. They're doing it this way in your name.
Ooh.
And they got critical. And Jesus said, in this visitation, leave them alone. Let them do it. They're building my kingdom. He said, and this criticism will start to hurt their hearts. It wears a man down. It's the way the demon wormwood will come in when there's just secret challenges and critiquing and offensing. So he was saying, and so I saw that, and I just finished with this, that the people were able to take this admonition. I want this to go out across the body of Christ, this admonition, because there were those who were ready to go public against one another, and they just needed to be quiet. Because anytime you walk close to imperfect human beings, me, you're going to see weaknesses. But if you don't have teams that cover your weaknesses as much as they cover your strength, because when I go out on the road in a lot of places where I don't have a team, my weaknesses are just as glaring as my strengths. And so people get confused. And so this ability for us to have as leadership and just individuals in the body of Christ, bowel movements. I saw all across the body of Christ the need for bowel movements. I know it's crude, but it is crude.
Well, and that means just get rid of the garbage, the yeah. waste, and the hurts and the wounds. Just let some time pass, let things go.
Yeah.
And don't carry the wounds and the baggage.
Yeah, and I've saw you superb at this. And a number of situations, because we've gotten to travel, and I've seen where you'll just say, it's my own stuff, and you'll go to your room, and you'll just be quiet until you clear the constipation out, because you
Absolutely.
Know every kind of, you
It is such a big deal. And Bobby, it's the opposite of what you just said about love and appreciation, the doors of appreciation. It's we actually hinder people. Is no. the opposite by not appreciating them, even what's said, you know, not to their face, but about them. And it's so easy to be critical. And I've been thinking about this recently, the power of our words. And we talk, in our prayer models about the power of our words, but the power of spoken words about other human beings can never, ever be erased. A thought is a vapor that has no substance. But when you speak it, if I speak publicly about my friend Bob Hartley or about anything else, those words can never, ever be erased. They are eternal.
And the
damage that's done, and I've just talked with one of my good friends, not you, about words that he spoke that have damaged his relationships. And have really shut major doors. It was not the Lord's will, but it was this thing. It's just be quiet for 24 hours. Be quiet for 24 hours. Say nothing, because you will only regret it. You will only hurt people and only shut doors. And then people turn against you, and people block you because you're dangerous. And it's not wrong for them necessarily to do that.
No, that's right.
And because you are dangerous, the words are so important. Words are life and death. They create life. They create death.
Well, and I came up in an environment, a Catholic, and then when I lived in Israel, well, everybody shouted everything they thought in the moment. But they were pretty cleansed afterwards. Mm-hmm. And nobody really gave it a lot of weight. In America, I think there's a different approach, and I think in God there's a different approach, where you guard your tongue. The Bible says to guard your tongue, and I would agree with you. I would add this about guarding your thoughts, even.
Yeah.
A thought is a vapor, but if you allow that self-talk about a human being to be repeated, you know, and I've had that happen in this season, the critiquing of the great kings that are supposed to come forth to help this financial crisis, to help our political crisis. I've had self-talk come in me about ones I know the Lord is going to anoint to help talk to Pelosi, who is going to help talk to Obama. I mean, really, really, really are going to talk to him. But I've had self-talk to Petraeus, you know, who's running the affairs in Afghanistan, different places, you know, because those situations will really affect us and our children's children and our ability to have the gospel come forth. So the self-talk, where it's a demonic talk, will create an invisible cord between two human beings.
It does.
Where there's this distance, or there's this love and appreciation. So I would say prophetically in this encounter, he said, you can not only critique one another verbally out loud, then it's out there. But internally, don't trust it if it's a lying voice, because the enemy just wants to lie and tear down. So I'll feel it. And I said, that's not that person. You got to discover the source. So this emphasis of kings coming through the door and them coming through the door through appreciation, I believe that we got a real responsibility. The Bible is so clear, and I just want to say this so strong and finishing. And I am wanting but growing in this. It says, oh, no man but to love him.
Ooh.
And so there's this understanding of love, and love hopes all things, that God is opening up in this summer harvest. I said, what is the summer harvest for me? And he said, love. And so this morning I was on the phone, I think, with Jeff, and I said, it's love day. And I'll speak to people, you know, and they'll think he's having fun. He's on. No, the Lord spoke to me. Harvest of love. And the more that I love, the more as a patriarch, I'll open up the doors for an Eddie or others, and I'm an Eddie for me or you for me.
I think this is awesome. I think it's trying to see past personalities and see the presence and fragrance of Christ in one another. You know, and when we're looking at people, we tend to see the weakness, but can we discern Christ behind the personality to appreciate the work he's doing, not only in them, but through them, where we can receive their unique fingerprint, their unique expression. And it goes back to that Mark chapter 12, 30 to 31, when we begin to gaze on God, focus on him, grow in love for him. We grow in love for ourselves. And he says, you know, this first and second commandment. The second is to love your neighbor as yourself. And I think to the degree we see and appreciate ourselves in God's love is to the degree and measure we're going to appreciate the beauty of another. And I just love that Lord is saying, see me in them and see my work in them and don't exploit their flaws. Champion the seed of the seed of life that's growing in them.
Yeah, that's growing in them. That's
and the
good.
Expression, the variety. You know, he's the God that makes all snowflakes different, as simple as that may sound.
Yeah.
We all have a different facet on that diamond which expresses his beauty, which may not be received well by everybody else.
You as a snowflake are different from me as a snowflake.
You know, different shape.
You're a beautiful snowflake.
Amen. That's excellent.
Say
we
end. It's just the expression of the beauty of God
that's
in each other.
So good.
Yes. It's a year of love and decrees. So next CENTCOM, I believe, let's start off with decrees over these ones that will be those that help bring these kings and queens the doors.
Why don't you close us in prayer and just confession and profession.
World count, Tom.
Confession and profession. Why don't you close us in prayer and profession and confession for just that we would love one another. Just
oh, that's perfect.
We would walk this out.
Excellent. Lord, we do state that we'll be like you. Son of God, we just observe how you walked across the planet and that you were the fulfillment of Isaiah 61, that you came to heal the sick, to take care and heal the lame, to raise the dead, to remove the spirit of heaviness, and to put on people a garment of praise. You got up and you read the book in Luke 4, that Isaiah 61. And it was the emphasis of that passage was how you came to broken human beings and how you loved them and you valued them and how you restored them and how you gave them beauty for ashes, you say, in that passage. How you went to the adulterous woman. You gave her back her dignity. How you went to that woman at the well who had been mistreated. Lessened, cheapened, degraded, and you gave her back her dignity. And so we see you as a God of love. That 1 John 4 is true that you said, this is who I am, a God of love. You said, ask Philippians 1, 8, 9, that we might abound in love. So we declare our God that we will be known as men and women of love and that we will help kings and queens walk into the door of appreciation, that we won't see their flaws, but we will be like you, the one, 1 Peter 4, that's fervent in love. We will be like you, the one who makes marvelous your love, to a people in besieged cities and challenging circumstances. We will be like you who, yes, our God is the one who is passionate, pursuing in love. We will be like you, our God, that it says that you shout with joy and you jump and shout with love. Zephaniah 3:16, 17 over people as they come. We will be like you by your grace at 1 Corinthians 13, where we will have that love that has the eyes of you, Jesus, for human beings. So we release that impartation right now of that abounding love, that greater than love, that refreshing love, that valuing of human beings love, that loving to be with people and celebrating who they are kind of love. And we thank you for that love making a difference in the marketplace, in the financial crises, in the way nations relate. So the fear and the greed and the protectionism is overcome by the reality of you and the marveling at you in your love go forth across the nations. We look for miracles this week of where ones rise up that are leaders in different places that have been anointed in love to bring forth a different song versus hiding their and hoarding. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, thanks again for watching this week's CENTCOM. I hope that you are blessed. And I just love hearing just what Bob and Eddie are talking about, is that really just this proper perspective of kings and queens being raised up, benevolent ones, and just the richness that God's doing in this time. And I had written down here that just kings must learn to hear every day. And that's really what we're doing, is we're giving you real building blocks to hear. And to hear him, hear his voice as this God of hope. And one of the best ways that we do that is, again, the Adoration Prayer Book. It's such a simple, practical book. You want to grab that. And then, two, we have a resource for you called the 52 Weeks of Hope. That is such a practical, step-by-step resource that you can tune into every week and really be mentored by what the Lord has given Bob and put on his heart. And so it's such a powerful time, and the Deeper Waters team. So encourage you to go look for that. And then third, if you've been impacted by this message, we would love to hear a testimony from you. We get literally testimonies every single day of what God's doing around the world in hope. So if you'd like just to write that down on an email, you can see there on the screen where you can send it to. We'd love to hear from you. So be blessed, and we are going to be back with you next week again with Bob and Eddie B. So be blessed. See you next week.